الحمد لله نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونؤمن به ونتوكل عليه ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا، من يهده الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلله فلا هادي له، ونشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له، ونشهد أن سيدنا ونبينا ومولانا محمدا عبده ورسوله. أما بعد، فأعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم، بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. وما آتاكم الرسول فخذوه وما نهاكم عنه فانتهوا، صدق الله العظيم. سبحانك لا علم لنا إلا ما علمتنا إنك أنت العليم الحكيم. رب اشرح لي صدري ويسر لي أمري واحلل عقدة من لساني يفقه قولي. دروس شيخ الله. Respected brothers, respected elders, mothers and sisters listening at home, Alhamdulillah, a significant amount of tarikh, history of Makkah al-Mukarramah has been covered, and we are in the blessed month of Sha'ban and awaiting the month of Ramadan. Inshallah, tonight's session of Dars Hadith will be the last session on the history of Makkah al-Mukarramah. Inshallah, from next week it will be the month of Ramadan. And in the month of Ramadan, after Salatul Taraweeh, every day inshallah we will have a program of Bayan. And after Fajr Salah, Seerat of Hazrat Nabi Kareem sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. In tonight's session, I wish to talk on some of the masajid that are in the city of Makkah and that hold great virtue. I don't think we have covered that, the masajid. One very famous masjid in the city of Makkah is Masjid-e-Ja'rana. Masjid-e-Ja'rana is approximately 18 miles out from the city of Makkah. But it is part of the city of Makkah, and it's famously known for Hazrat Nabi Kareem sallallahu alayhi wa sallam visiting that area, and Abu sallallahu alayhi wa sallam put on his ihram for Umrah from the area of Ja'rana. Initially this mosque was known as Masjid-e-Aqsa, but later on Masjid-e-Aqsa was changed to Masjid-e-Ja'rana. It is said that there is a possibility that there was a woman living in that area who looked after the masjid and that part of the area, and she was the wife of Asad bin Abdul Uzza, and her name was Ja'rana, and the name given to the masjid is after her, Masjid-e-Ja'rana. Sallallahu alayhi wa sallam put on his ihram for Ja'rana. I don't know if any of the brothers have been to Masjid al-Ja'rana. I'm sure you have. When people go to make ziyarat and when they want to do Umrah, they usually go to Masjid al-Tan'im or Masjid al-Ja'rana. And Masjid al-Ja'rana, if you put your ihram for Masjid al-Ja'rana, it's termed as Bara Umrah. Bara Umrah. That's what the people say, that we are going to perform a big Umrah. So they go to Masjid al-Ja'rana. And mashallah, if you go to Masjid al-Ja'rana, in the masjid there is facility to cater for thousands of people. MashaAllah, facility for ghusl, shower, toilet, everything is there. The mosque is air conditioned, and a lot of brothers go there and come back in the city of Makkah with their ihram, and they read their rak'atain and they start the salbiyah from Masjid al-Ja'rana. Now, one great virtue of Masjid al-Ja'rana is that Abu sallallahu alayhi wa sallam has said approximately 300 prophets have come to Masjid al-Ja'rana. Seen so Anbiya alayhi wa sallam. Makkah al-Mukarramah, the Kaaba, is the first building that is standing from right the beginning of Hazrat Adam alayhi salam, and even the angels that were here and the jinns were here. It is the first structure, first building. And all the prophets that came, they made ziyarat of Khanas Kaaba. Rasulullah alayhi wa sallam says 300 prophets came to Masjid al-Zi'rana, as in that area, and they wore the ihram and they came to Makkah al-Mukarramah to make tawaf. So it is extremely important, mashallah. It's of great virtue that when we go to Makkah al-Mukarramah, we must not miss out from this site and perform our umrah so that we can fulfill one great sunnah of Nabi Kareem sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. It is so important to have knowledge and also the right guide who knows everything. Not only is he rich in Islamic history, but he is also a scholar, and he takes you to all the places, because there are so many places, mashallah. There is one place where a lot of people never go to and make ziyarat of, is Masjid-e-Kabasha. Masjid-e-Kabasha is a masjid where Sayyidina Ibrahim alayhi salatu wa salam had taken Ismail alayhi salatu wa salam, and he stopped there to carry out the command of Allah to, mashallah, sacrifice his son Ismail alayhi salam, the vision that he saw. And that place is still there today, mashallah, untouched. It's like an open area with four walls around it. Al-Masjid al-Kabasha. A lot of the people, the guides there, don't want to take the Hujjan to Masjid al-Kabasha. Why? Because it is in a very awkward area. It's near Mina. But one must insist that when you go there, one must visit Masjid al-Kabasha. That is the exact spot where Jibreel Amin came down from the heavens with an animal as a substitute for Hazrat Ismail alayhi salatu wassalam. So Masjid al-Kabasha is one masjid that we must make ziyarat of. Also Masjid Abu Bakr in the city of Makkah. Masjid Abu Bakr was the house of Sayyidina Abu Bakr Siddiq radiyallahu ta'ala an. It is said that in this house, Hazrat Abu Bakr Siddiq radiallahu ta'ala an had reserved a separate room in which he would worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala all night. And that is full of barakat, mashallah. And today a beautiful masjid is standing on that spot. It is also said that when Nabi Kareem sallallahu alayhi wa sallam went for his migration, when the command of Hijrah came, Abdullah alayhi wa sallam first went to visit Hazrat Abu Bakr Siddiq in his house, and this is the same house where the masjid is standing today. So this is the first station, the first platform from where Abdullah alayhi wa sallam started his hijrah. So Masjid Abu Bakr, Masjid al-Kabasha, and Masjid al-Jinn. Masjid al-Jinn ka bhi to naam suna hoga aapne? Have you seen Masjid al-Jinn? Masjid al-Jinn again is a masjid that one should visit. It is said that Huzur alayhi salatu wa salam was performing his salah in that part of the masjid, and a group of jinns came and they heard Huzur alayhi salatu wa salam recite the Quran, and this is in Surah Jinn. قُلْ أُوحِيَ إِلَيَّ أَنَّهُ سَمَعَ نَفَرٌ مِّنَ الْجِنِّ فَقَالُوا إِنَّا سَمِعْنَا قُرْآنًا عَجَبًا. And they said to each other that, subhanAllah, the recitation that we are hearing, this is a beautiful recitation. Quran and Ajaba, يَهْدِي إِلَى الرُّشْدِ فَآمَنَّا بِهِ. And all of them embraced Islam. Sare jinn Musalman hoge. It is also said that it is in the area of Masjid al-Jinn where Huzur alayhi salatu wa salam told Hazrat Abdullah ibn Mas'ud radiallahu ta'ala an, that I have a meeting with the jinns. I want you to stand in this spot. And Abdullahu alayhi wa sallam made a square for him, four lines in the ground, and told him to be in the middle of this, the lines that Huzur alayhi salatu wa sallam made. And he said to Huzur Abdullah ibn Mas'ud that the jinns cannot do anything to you. The jinns cannot do anything. And Hazrat Abdullah ibn Mas'ud radiallahu ta'ala an had said that if the lines were not there made by Huzur alayhi salatu wa salam, there was a possibility that the jinns would have killed me. Abdullah alayhi wa sallam made four lines for him like a square, and he was in the middle. Subhanallah. That is why a lot of the Amirin, when there is a jinn in the house or something, and they want to trap him, what they do is they have nails, and they pray on the nails, and they blow on it. And they put the nails on all the sides of the wall. And some of the Amirin say the barakah of this is that it depends who the Amil is. The barakah of it is that the jinns cannot trespass, cannot enter that chamber, that room. So the whole house is protected. So Masjid al-Jinn again is a masjid one should visit. Going back to Masjid al-Jarana, 300 Anbiya alayhi salatu wa salam have visited the area of Jarana. It is also said that in the area of Jarana, Abdullahu alayhi wa sallam, he himself dug a well, and sweet water came out from that well, and Abdullahu alayhi wa sallam drank from that well, and he also gave that water to the companions. Wallahu alam, I'm not quite sure if this well is still there, but certainly Masjid al-Jarana is still there. If you find the right guide who has been in the city of Makkah or Madinatul Munawwara for a long period of time, and you get some mu'allims and shuyukh who are in the masjid, especially in Masjid al-Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and if you find the right person, they are full of knowledge and they will explain to you every part of Masjid al-Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and every part of Masjid al-Haram. It all depends who you talk to. So one masjid is Masjid al-Jarana, 18 miles away from the city of Makkah. Another very famous masjid is Masjid al-San'im. The Masjid al-San'im that stands today is one of the most beautiful masjids in Makkah al-Mukarramah. If you see the interior, if you can remember, it's like built-in light in every corner of the masjid. It's a beautiful masjid. It is said that Sultan Mahmud Ghaznavi, when he came for Hajj or Umrah, he reconstructed Masjid al-San'im in his time. So Masjid al-San'im, again, it is full of history. And the name that is given to the Masjid, San'im, is after a mountain that is located on the right-hand side of the Masjid. On the right-hand side of the Masjid is a mountain which is known as Jabal-e-Na'im. And the word Na'im in the Arabic language basically means a blessing, a ni'mat. And San'im in the Arabic language means that individual that is blessed by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Jisko kuch ni'mat mili ho, ya hasil ho. And that is why this masjid is known as Masjid al-Tan'im. It is said that when in the year 9 Hijri, Abdullahu alayhi wa sallam, when he performed his Hajj, Hazrat Aisha Siddiqa radiallahu ta'ala anha was with Huzur alayhi salatu wa salam, and due to some reasons she had to delay her Hajj and she could not do the tawaf of Kaaba. So Abdullahu alayhi wa sallam said to her that it is better for you to go to Masjid al-Tan'im and put on your ihram and make niyat and go from Masjid al-Tan'im to Makkah and do the tawaf of the Kaaba. Sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said to her that go and travel with your brother Abdul Rahman bin Abu Bakr. Abdul Rahman bin Abu Bakr. Again, the ulama say that one very important wasla should be understood here. Even a distance just from Makkah to Masjid al-Tan'im, Sallallahu alayhi wa sallam did not allow a lady to travel alone. Now Sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said to her that she must travel with Hazrat Abdul Rahman, who was her brother, her mahram. So it is extremely important today, our mothers and sisters, alhamdulillah, they have this understanding that when they go for Hajj and Umrah, first of all, if they don't have a mahram, visa will not be granted. And the Saudi embassy, the Saudi authority is very strict with this. Alhamdulillah, which is good. But what our mothers and sisters have to understand generally, to travel alone without a mahram, if you're traveling over 48 miles, it is not jail. The lady has to travel with a mahram. That is the masla. Here, again, a great lesson صلى الله عليه وسلم said to Hazrat Aisha radiallahu ta'ala anha, or Abu sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was also there. And Hazrat Aisha radiallahu ta'ala anha then put on her ihram and she went back to Makkah al-Mukarramah and she did her tawaf. Hazrat Suraqa bin Malik radiallahu ta'ala anha, Allah give him jazai khair, he questioned Huzur alayhi salatu wa salam at that time. He says, Ya Rasulullah, if the days of Hajj have passed, are we allowed to perform Umrah? Or this Umrah that Hazrat Aisha performed was only for her and for your family members and for you only? Is it only exclusive for you? Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam said, no, it is hillat, it is ja'iz for every ummah of mine. After the Hajj period, straight away he can perform his Umrah. So a lot of masail are derived from this one question that was put forward to Hazrat Nabi Kareem sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Our ulama have always been accustomed to making Umrah on the 27th of Ramadan. 27th of Ramadan. We have fixed Laylatul Qadr for the 27th. That is our problem, that we have fixed it. Quran is made khatam, and we do all the crying on the 27th. And after 27, 28, 29 is 50. Yeah. Ramzan is all over. Once the Quran is completed, Ramzan is over. Yeah. When he reads, when the Imam reads, Alam tara kayfa fa'ala rabbuka, bas khatam. This is not the right attitude. SubhanAllah. Laylatul Qadr can also be on the 29th. Yes, according to some of the ulama, it is on the 27th. But ulama have had this habit that they perform Umrah if they were in Makkah al-Mukarramah on the 27th of Ramadan. Another thing to note is that, alhamdulillah, I'm not going to talk on this in the manner of making ziyarat, la hawla wa la quwwata illa billah, of this mal'oon whose name is Abu Lahab and his wife. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, sabbat yada abi lahabin wa sabbah. Ma aghna anhu maluhu wa ma kasab. Where is Abu Lahab? Abu Lahab ki kabar kaha hai? Abu Lahab is also on the road of Masjid Tan'im. That is where he is. Right on that main road. If you can remember that, if you're in a taxi and when you come to Masjid Tan'im, what you have to do is the road goes past Masjid Tan'im and round. So you come from one end and you go round the masjid and go back. And right on the main road on the right hand side is the qabr of this mal'oon. He and his wife both are buried together. And one of the signs of the qabr of Abu Lahab is that if you go there, always 24 hours a heap of stones are always there. A mountain of stones. Jaise hum shaitan ko pelt karte hain, shaitan ko pelt karte. The Saudi government got tired, and now what they do is that they don't tell people that Abu Lahab is there. Because when they inform this, give information to the Muslims, out of anger, what they do is they go to the grave of Abu Lahab and they throw stones on him. So even now, in fact, from the time of Tabi'een, this was the practice, like how they would tell the shaitan when they would come to Masjid Tan'im, they would stop on the side and take stones and pelt Abu Lahab. Now Abu Lahab is that man who would throw stones on Huzur alayhi salatu wasalam al-Yazim. When Abu sallallahu alayhi wasallam would go to the souq of Uqqan and he would say to the people, قُلْ لَا إِلَهَ إِلَّا اللَّهِ تُفْلِحُونَ. Say la ilaha illallah and salvation will be given to you. It was Abu Lahab and his partners that would aliyazu billah spit on the face of Hazrat Nabi Kareem sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and throw stones on Huzur alayhi salatu wa sallam. Today Allah has disgraced him, humiliated him, that even on his, in the area where he is, wo to jahannam ka ek tukra hai uske liye, there is a heap of stones there. This is Masjid Zairana and Masjid Tan'im, two very famous masjids of Makkah al-Mukarramah. Another two masjids are Masjid Khaf and Masjid Namira. Masjid Khaf is in Mina, and Masjid Namira is in the part of Arafat. Half of it is in Arafat and half of it is outside Arafat. So when you enter Masjid Namira, there is a clear board there saying in all the different languages that if you have crossed this boundary, then your Hajj is invalidated. It will not count. Why? The Masjid is there to give the Hujjaj shade in the intense heat when they are standing in the plains of Arafat. And a lot of the Hujjaj go there, but we have to be very, very careful that they don't cross the boundary. You have to be in the zone of Arafat. And Masjid Khaf, again, a Masjid full of virtue. It is really impossible for anyone in this period of Hajj to go and get a place inside Masjid Khaf unless he's been there well before, few days before. Because where the camps are for all the Europa camps, those coming from England, it is quite far from Masjid Khaf. Masjid Khaf again has a lot of virtue. Abu Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, Imam Faqih Rahmatullah Alayh, has said that at least 75 prophets have visited Masjid Khaf. 75. And from 75, one is Hazrat Musa Alayhi Salam. Hazrat Musa Alayhi Salam has also been in that Masjid. So it is full of virtue. When you read the tarikh of Makkah al-Mukarramah, there is mustaqil fazilat of Masjid Khaf, Masjid Namira, all the masajid that are there in the area of Mina and Arafat. It is also said that Huzur alayhi salatu wa salam once said to the people that if I was to stay in Makkah al-Mukarramah, then I would make sure that once in a week, and that is Yawm al-Sabt, Saturday, Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam said that I would always visit Masjid Khaf on a Saturday. Yes. So it is full of virtue, mashallah, when you make ziyarat. It would be very nice, especially in the time of Hajj, because in the time of Hajj, the Masjid is open for everyone to go and perform at least one namaz in Masjid Khaf, and that will be a great blessing. Inshallah ta'ala, we end our session of Dars Hadith and the Tariq of Makkah al-Mukarramah in explaining the Tariq of some of the Masajid. Insha'Allah ta'ala, if Allah wills, we will continue with it after the month of Ramadan. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala give us all the tawfiq to make amal on what has been said. Wa akhiru da'wana and alhamdulillahi rabbil alameen. Durushitullah. اللهم صل على سيدنا ونبينا ومولانا محمد النبي الأمي وعلى آله وسلم تسليما. اللهم تقبل منا وتب علينا إنك أنت التواب الرحيم. اللهم إنا نسألك من خير ما سألت منه نبيك عبدك محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم، ونعوذ بك من شر ما استعاذك منه نبيك عبدك محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم، وأنت المستعان وعليك البلاغ، ولا حول ولا قوة إلا بالله. سمعنا وأطعنا، غفرانك ربنا وإليك المصير، برحمتك يا أرحم الراحمين.